Oh, White Lung. Excuse me. God, there's too many white bands.
Can say that again.
In many ways.
You know what really makes us mad? Is wasting money on CDs with only one or two good songs.
Yeah. Tell them about punk.
What's up, posers? Welcome to Punk Lotto Pod. We are going to pick up right where we left off in our best of the 2010s. So, not much of a preamble here, just jumping right into 2014.
I really hope this comes across better than, remember that record? 2 weeks of us just going, I liked this one.
Remember
this one? It's fine. Once we get closer to today, we're going to be like, and there's less to talk about.
But speaking of 2014 and being sick of Self-Defense Family, Try Me came out.
Try Me, I think, is what killed them for me.
I didn't like that record when it came out.
No.
I thought it sounded like trash. And I thought it was really poorly recorded. I thought the songs were stupid and repetitive and annoying and edgelordy.
I thought the decision to make it a double LP with an interview on both sides of the B-sides, both B-sides of a former sex worker, I thought it was exploitive.
Yeah.
He would argue that it's not, but whatever. I'm so sick of Pat Kinlan's hot takes. And even though he said a lot of things that I have agreed with over the years and some things I continue to refer to, like Brent. Yeah. He's not wrong on everything, but he has an edgelordy hot take attitude that I'm just like, all right, you're just trying to justify your own shitty behavior. Stop it.
Yeah.
Try me, Self-Defense Family. I didn't like that record, and then I continued to listen to them for another 3 years, or at least listen to everything they put out for like another 3 years, but nothing I enjoyed. It was purely just to see if I could catch that magic of stuff that I liked earlier, but none of the musicians that I liked in the band were still in the band, and Pat got lazier and lazier and lazier. So
yeah. I thought their 2015 album Heaven Is Earth had some good songs.
Yeah, it's fine. It just was too samey.
2014
is the year of the Hotelier.
Yeah.
Who likes that band? Everyone.
Prawn.
Yeah. Oh, this is the era of emo bands that I don't care about anymore, but everyone else still liked. There's a lot of Speed record. Did he care about? There's a Piano's Become the Teeth record.
Yeah. Dude Incredible by Shellac of North America.
When did they change their name to that?
Listened to probably the first three songs and was done.
Talk about a band with one good song.
Two.
What's the other one?
Copper.
I think 2014's a bad year. just off this first page. Important records, Joyce Manor's Never Hung Over Again. Against Me's Transgender Dysphoria Blues. That's I almost wonder if that record itself is that important or if Against Me became more important at that time point. Cause I don't know any songs on that record, but what else? Important.
That's 68 record. People really like that band.
They're fun live. I mean, that's my takeaway from them.
Yeah. I've listened to that album. It's fine.
I don't think it comes across as on record as well as Josh Scoggin is.
Yeah. I mean, if you can't see Josh Scoggin, like, standing on the kick drum.
Yeah. But, see, and, well, like, Scoggin,
running all over the place, it's just not
he does
the same.
Do the vocal equivalent of that with his weird, like, stutter lines and hanging on to, like, a syllable for really extended periods. He has a lot of, like, fun vocal tricks that he does. It's the type of thing you do goofing around and practice, and then he's like, wait, we can do that on the record.
Yeah. Yeah.
That Sports record, who are now called Remember Sports, just got, like, a massive reissue. Like, they just reissued, like, all of the early actually even including the new record, like a remaster, reissue, re-release, because that last Remember Sports record sold out like the first year it came out. So they just did a huge reissue of that Sunchokes record. It's one I haven't really listened to very much, but that's a band that I think is going to become very important in the next couple of years. I think Remember Sports' album from 2018 is going to go down as a classic. This record is starting to become a retroactive classic. So they're the next Waxahachie, I think, as far as like impact on the mainstream and stuff like that. The music journalist crew. What else? That Free Throw record, I guess, was a big deal, but that band is so boring.
Let's see.
Chumped put out Teenage Retirement. Broke them.
Yeah. I remember, I want to say Pat from Self Defense Family was talking about Chumped being a pushed band.
I remember.
There was a lot of expectation for them and it didn't pan out.
They were.
That's why they broke up.
I remember the year before they put out their EP and it was talked about by everyone at Fest. They were like, oh, you heard about this Chumped band? Like, they were that band that everybody was... Caves was that band a few years before. They were that band that everyone was walking around and talking about. And this record came out.
I just imagine someone... Like, people are just walking around, like, talking about Chumped, and then someone stopping and going, did you say Chumped? I also really like Chumped.
What?
Just random people who don't know each other, like... hearing each other talking about Chumped and then stopping and saying Chumped.
They were... Mikey Erg...
Imagine, like, the Bort. Like,
yeah.
My son is also named Bort.
Mikey Erg repped them real hard early on, so everybody in, like, Fest punk community was like, yep, we're into this band now. And then this record came out, and everybody in the Fest punk community was like, yep, we love this band. And then I don't think the rest of the world cared. And then they were like, all right, we're breaking up. We should have gone and watched Chumped play their last... set. Why didn't we? Who? What dumb flavor of the month did we go see instead?
I don't know, but I want to say there was. I do remember watching Chumped one year.
Yeah, yeah.
And Palomino. It was in the Palomino, and I was like standing on something just to see over the crowd of people in that room. But I was equally watching that. I was watching Chumped, but I was also watching. I want to say it was like Rambo 3. On a TV. It was like along the wall, like just kind of off to the side of the band. So it was just like I would watch the band and then my eyes would drift and I'd watch Rambo for a little bit and then I'd go back to the band.
I guess on this page, the Menzingers Rented World came out. That was a big deal.
Nervous Like Me, Cayetana. That's a good record. It's not a great record, but it's a pretty good record.
There's a Modern Baseball record. You're gonna miss it all. Lawrence Arms had their comeback record, Metropole, and it was okay. That Somos record's a big deal. Temple of Plenty. Oh, here's a big record. Code Orange put out I Am King. This is where they stopped being kids.
30 minutes of breakdowns.
New metal as fuck. It's fine. I like the older stuff better, but whatever. They got mainstream, whatever. Good for them. I've never heard anything bad about them other than they are kind of rock star-ish, but I don't know if that's just come in the recent years. That other sport band, Bon Voyage. There's too many bands called sport.
Yeah.
What's your personal habits in 2014? What are you listening to?
This was a big year for me. The further back into the charts we get, the more I see the bands that I was listening to. But let's wait for this helicopter to go by. For me, my number one, and it's a record I still love very dearly, Sliding Through the Halls of Fate by Crowbait. Punk rock for me.
I think I figured out my favorite type of music.
Stop doing that.
What?
I think I figured out something.
I don't have a fully finished thought before I start my sentence.
Dino Rider.
Does it sound like I have a lisp?
No, you just keep doing that. Like, yeah. Then this is like, this is the mid-tempo.
Yeah, I like
grown-up punk,
not slow but not fast punk. I like melodies. I like some. If it's got a little twangy riff in there, I'm really into that.
Yeah, I mean it's the weaker thans.
Yeah, that's true. That is true.
Brand of punk.
I think this year, I always loved the Weaker Thans, but I think this year, I listened to some of their records more than I have in the last 5 years. So either there's something very wrong with me, or the Weaker Thans are like one of my all-time favorite bands, and I didn't notice that until now. I don't know. Maybe I'm just very sad.
Hoodwinked by Level Up came out that year.
Big deal. It was
huge.
It was a critical hit. It was a scene hit.
And I really liked it.
And I liked it. Yeah, that's true. There's you need all three.
It was one of those rare records where everyone was into it, and I was too.
Yeah. That if you haven't noticed, that is one of the things about us and why we constantly try and get guests on, which we probably should have had some guests for this. But whatever, is that we tend to not like what everybody else likes, not out of some, I'm cooler than you type thing, or just I'm different type thing. It's just, it just doesn't do anything for me. Whatever most people are into, I try it. Like, I'm not like the type of person who's like, everybody likes that, I'm not even going to bother. No, like, I try and go into anything with an open mind, but it just isn't my... It means that my taste is not the same as what most people's taste is, and not in a bad way or good way. It just is.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't think it's like my taste is better. Mm-mm. It's just like, it's a little bit weird.
It's more eccentric? No, it's more hyper-specific.
Yeah, but, yeah. In a sort of a similar lane of indie rock, I guess, Torch Song by Radiator Hospital.
Oh, yeah. That's the one where everybody's like, hey, this Radiator Hospital band that has, like, 50 EPs, they're really good. Right? Is that the one?
Yeah. Yeah, that's the one where everyone started listening.
It was one of those ones that I discovered at the end of the year, and I was like, whoa, why didn't I know about this record earlier? Oh, no, no, no. The one before is the one I got into. Torch Song is 2014. Yeah. I got into the one before. Something Wild, which apparently wasn't... Radio Music apparently didn't put that in 2013's punk records because I didn't have it on my list, but whatever.
It's indie rock.
It's not punk.
2014
was the year of Beach Slang.
Right.
Who would ever want anything so broken and Cheap Thrills on a Dead End Street? Both came out the same year. I don't think I've ever seen a band burn out as fast as Beach Slang. The hype on these two EPs going into the first LP was so massive, and then no one cared about that LP when it actually came out. Or, like, it was like, hey, it's good. And then everybody stopped listening to it very quickly. I wonder how much of that became, oh, what's the deal with Alex James? Oh, he's got like an
outfit.
Ooh, he wears that every show? Oh, okay.
He's kind of weird.
He's like 40, right? And he's singing about being a teenager.
I loved those EPs.
Yeah.
So much. I still love those songs.
Yeah.
They, like those songs and that Crowbait album. Like, they rewired my brain. Like, I really wanted to play music again.
Yeah.
So that shows you how long I've been working on that.
Yeah. One of my favorite records that year was Bear Trades, Blood and Sand. They were a UK punk band from, like, Northern England, and they sang with the thickest Northern English accent I've ever heard in a punk band. So, but they also played that Iron Sheik style of melodic, like, kind of gruff punk. And part of what really drew me into that album is just how they pronounced words and their unique way of saying words on the record that I was just like, well, I'm listening to this over and over and over again. I still love those two albums they put out. They weren't huge. They had two LPs. They didn't tour the U.S. extensively, so it kind of limited their exposure, but I don't know. They're one of my favorite bands ever. I have so many bands that I'm like, yeah, they're one of my favorite bands, and people would be like, what? Who? Why? I don't know. They just do it for me.
2014 was also when Dark Blue released Pure Reality.
Hell yeah.
I listened to the shit out of that album. Like, I really hated my job, and that record, really, the whole mood of that record is, I really fucking hate my job.
Mm-hmm.
So it just resonated with me so much, and that record's just so good.
Hard Girls put out 1,000 Surfaces. Is that the last Hard Girls record to come out, or has there been another one since then?
There was another one.
Oh, okay. Yeah. This is the best one, I think.
Hard Girls was a band that I came across in, like, 2009 or 10. I listened to their EP Hello a lot.
Mm-hmm. There was a debate for a while, which girls band did you like the best? Hard Girls and the canceled Cheap Girls. And Hard Girls were better in the long run. In fact, Mike Eugenor sounds like a really fucking awesome dude. So,
yeah. He's like a reporter in the Bay Area.
And he's kind of an activist, right? Or he's just... Yeah,
and heavily involved with DIY music and in that area. And then has been in, you know, Shinobu and Kitty Cat Fan Club. And seems like an all-around good dude.
Yeah.
He's like a not annoying... because he was in, in what's his name? Playing Shinobu too.
Oh, Jeff Rosenstock?
Jeff Rosenstock, yeah.
Yeah, he wasn't in Shinobu, but he, like, played with them when they played Fest and stuff like that. I think he may be on that last Shinobu record.
Yeah.
Shinobu, yeah, you're right.
And Hard Girls have, like, kind of the sound of Jeff Rosenstock's music, but I like it.
Yeah.
It's not really annoying.
No. Continuing down the list, Typesetter put out Wild's End. I think that's my favorite record by them. They're a band I've seen probably like 5 times at Fest now. I think that's their best record. I got into them around a lot of other Black Numbers bands at the same time. So I got into them. I got into Lilac Days, and then our friends in Muscle and Bone put out their record on Black Numbers. Muscle and Bone's Peace and Light came out. God, I love that band. A record I was listening to a lot was Mode Modern's Occult Delight. This is when that post-punk thing, I think, is really starting to take off. One that I was listening to extensively. And I guess the last big one for me would be The Weeks, The World is a Terrible Place, and I Hate Myself and I Want to Die. Still my favorite Weeks release before they changed their name to the Super Weeks. I liked them kind of making fun of the world is.
Yeah, I like that Weeks a lot. I've liked everything that they've done, though.
Very true. There's nothing I don't like.
I've seen them a few times, and they're really fun live.
Yeah.
We saw them at Fest, and they played... Did we see them in... What was that? 1985?
1982.
1982?
Yeah. Yeah, we saw them in there, and there were like 7 of them playing.
Yeah.
Because they started sort of as a collective type thing, where it was like there wasn't a set lineup, and they would just kind of rotate members a lot. Like, the main two were Evan and... Oh, what's his name?
Riz? I don't know.
I don't remember. Sorry.
Yeah, don't tag him in the Instagram post.
Yeah. I'm going to tag every band we've talked about.
Yeah. There's a...
What is 2014 punk?
I listened to a lot of it. I don't know that there's one thing.
And I think this is where punk stops being a well-defined series of subgenres. Now it's just... I think this is the beginning of a vague-ass... Like, it's more of an attitude. But not in, like, a 70s, 80s attitude way. I think it just got... It got so subgenred. And then I think people's taste is much broader now. I don't know that people are as tied to the scene as they used to be. I think you may be tied to your local scene, if anything, but I don't think there's like an identity. Well, there kind of is. Indie DIY dudes are like a thing. Collared polos, striped polos, and dad hats, and thick glasses. I'm describing myself, but not really.
There's a... I don't know. Looking at 2015.
Even less of a defined year. What is that?
Yeah, I mean... Oh, I didn't know if you had pulled it up yet.
I hadn't.
Number one, We Cool by Jeff Rosenstock.
Oh, that's what's...
Number two, Abyss by Chelsea Wolf.
Not really punk.
I don't know why. I guess they just put gothic rock under.
Yeah, subgenre.
Viet Cong, self-titled album.
Yeah, Preoccupations, yeah.
And then we've got Mathcore record I've never heard of.
That's gotta be retroactive. That band is more popular now than they were then.
There's like
how is Cattle Decap always in the top 10? Bellheads. There's a hype band.
Yeah.
Number 6, Cult Leader, Lightless Walk. I think we saw them this year in 2015. Good lord, we're only 2015. I didn't really listen to them too much, but they were fun live, I guess.
Ought, Proto Martyr. Kind of remember those bands being a little bit hyped.
I feel like they got bigger later.
This is where you're getting that post-punk revival, the Interpol thing.
Algiers.
Coming back. I mean,
what?
That's probably the most dominant sound of this year.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. But I am really surprised to see there's some records in the top 40 here that I would think Rate Your Music would not have.
Swami John Reese and the Blind Shake.
Put so high.
An instrumental surf record?
Well, I'm surprised that Imaginary Life by Warriors is number 30 on this list. Right off the bat, I was scared what you'd say. Barely played, not even old enough to trade. Started off well, then spiraled quickly. Couldn't see the forest through how you treat me. It's a bad sign when the fights were never.
I'm actually very happy that it is, though.
Right. It's a great record.
It's a great record. And Lauren Denizio, I believe, right? Lauren Measure? Yeah, Denizio. Is going to go down as one of the most important women in this time period of punk. When did the Measure start? I guess it's more the middle period, because they started in 2005. But she became such a big figure at the end of the Measure's, like, kind of run. And they just announced this week that there's going to be a new Warriors record that comes out next year.
Yeah, they're going to be touring with Ryan Fallon.
Oh, really? I didn't see that.
On his new record tour.
That's pretty cool. Yeah, I think Lauren Measure, Lauren Denizio, is going to go down as one of, like, the most important women in punk in this decade. Well deserved. She's an amazing songwriter, and I'm very dumb because I did not listen to the Warriors as much as I should have been the entire time. But that's on me. I have that on my conscience. Beach Slang put out their record, The Things We Do to Find People Who Feel Like Us. I hate that album title.
Yeah.
It's a bad album title. I could never remember that that's what it's called.
Yeah.
It's a good record, but it's been
a good record.
But it's been a long time since I've even listened to it. Cause he's so corny.
I mean, the magic is wearing off here, though.
Well, yeah, because this came out in 2015. They immediately rushed out a record in 2016, A Loud Bash of Teenage Feelings, that was underwhelming, and then have yet to release another album of new material. So.
Coming.
Yeah, I know. And I've heard some of them. And, ooh, am I not excited.
Yeah.
They decided they were going to release acoustic versions of their songs and cover songs for the last 4 years. So, thanks a lot, guys. Way to undercut your own momentum. But, whatever. sounds like I'm mad at Beach Slang.
Salty.
I went all in on them. I had to... Oh... Is it because I watched Cursive because of them? Is that why I'm... Oh, that was buried. I didn't even realize that.
You had to see Cursive, and that ruined Beach Slang for you.
That's... Man, I figured out the root of my displeasure of them. What? Page 2? I don't see shit on here worth talking about.
Yeah, there's weird stuff. Like,
there's a Saddest Landscape record that's pretty good. Darkness Forgives. Sprainard put out Mabel, which was underwhelming, but everybody said they liked it, so I don't know.
I liked it, but...
It's fine. It was good, but it
was... That, there's some big records that you're skipping here.
What am I missing?
Yeah, Well, Drug Church. I know it wasn't good, but everyone liked it.
Yes.
That Turnstile record, I tried listening to that record like 3 times that year and didn't get it. I just didn't get it. I was like, why is everyone freaking out about this? Not good. It's not. That Cloakroom record.
Yeah. I don't know. I think that's when everybody figured they didn't like Cloakroom.
I don't know.
I guess we're missing... Is this the middle of astronaut punk? Like,
Yeah, I mean, this is right there in the Hum Worship.
Yeah. We all love this band Failure that no one knew about until this year, but they were around in the 90s.
Yeah.
Where everybody lied and said they were Failure fans.
When did Tidal Fight put out that?
Green? Floral? Floral Green? Was that the year before? I think we're actually behind.
Well, they put out Floral Green in 2012, but Hyperview came out in 2015.
Oh, okay. So between them.
So
we're smack in the middle of Hum Worship.
Yeah.
Though, weirdly, it hasn't really reflected in these charts, which makes me think that it was purely just in the moment, and that spacey guitar fell out very quickly. What were you listening to?
Well, Sleep Through It by Wild Honey. That's one of my big highlights of the decade. I listened to that record a whole lot. I still listen to that record quite a bit. I love that band. They sounded so good. We talked about them for our My Bloody Valentine record, record, but we don't have to dig into it, but I definitely want to mention it. The first toy guitar record is, again, one of my favorites from this decade.
It wouldn't show up on the punk charts, and I saw it on my Tumblr page for like best albums of that year, so I'm glad that was there, because I would have missed that record, and that record is really great. Radio Music calls it something like glam rock or something like that.
Yeah, I mean, it's just a punk rock record. I don't know. I mean, like, it's got some, you know, John Reese style guitars and
Jack. I mean,
it's Jack.
And it came out on Fat Wreck. Like, you think that'd be enough to give it a punk tag? I had to actually tag it punk myself to make it show punk.
I stumbled across that one. I hadn't heard anything about it, and I was just looking at Bandcamp probably the month that it came out, looking for something to listen to, working at my temp job, when I would listen to like 8 hours of music a day.
Yeah.
In a windowless room.
You should have been listening to podcasts.
Yeah, I did a little bit. But I saw that record was like one of the highest like popular punk records or whatever on Bandcamp. So I listened to it and I was like, great. And then I found out later who it was. Like, yeah. That makes sense.
Yeah.
Actually, I love that band.
Looking at 2015, this is a pretty good year. Like, I didn't really feel much for 14, like 12, 13, and 14, but looking at these albums from 2015, there's a lot here that I, like, still love. So you were listening to that, and I was probably listening to... Oh, I listened to that record a lot myself. But I was also really enjoying Timeshare's album, Already Dead. They're doing that thing that I like. It's kind of mid-paced, not too fast punk with a little bit of twangy, rootsy guitars. I'm assuming that's partly the Beach Slang influence, or, you know, because they were so big at that point. So then other bands were like, hey, we can do Heartland punk as well. But one massive record for us that year was Coliseum's Anxiety's Kiss, which we did discuss extensively on the show at one point. But I still think it's their best record, and it was one of my favorites that year.
It's also the year of Party Adjacent
by, yes,
Dan Andriano.
Not listed as a punk record. I had to find that on my best of list, too.
Again, that's another, like, all-time of the decade record.
Mm-hmm.
I love that album. It's the best thing that anyone from Alkaline Trio has done this decade. Tin Thermidor by, yep, Shinobu.
Shinobu.
Came out that year.
Tin Thermidor. Also, that year was Winter Break's sole full-length album. The members of Summer Vacation lost a member and then changed their name to Winter Break. Another record I really, really enjoyed was Petal's record, Shame. I listened to that record quite a bit. It's so funny. Like, Radio Music doesn't want to call stuff that's clearly punk, punk, but they'll include this Petal record, which it's almost like piano music. Like, I don't... it's emo, I guess, but it's so, like, piano-based that I'm surprised it counts it, to be honest. It calls, yeah, it Midwestern emo, but she definitely comes across more as just singer-songwriter and indie rock stuff, but... Which I want to say that record maybe has some of the Tiger's Jaw people as well, but I'm not sure. I know the EP did, but yeah, I very, very much enjoyed that record. And I want to say we saw them on this record tour?
Yeah.
With Self Defense Family? No.
No.
Who was that with? It was the same venue. Who was that with?
It was with the Super Weeks.
Yeah, that's right, because Bad Year came out this year as well, which is like them going full Weezer core. Hey, that, yeah, was a thing. Remember Weezer core? Like, everybody?
Yeah, not very well represented in the charts here, but there was a lot of it.
Because Roswell Kid, they were doing that too. Did Roswell Kid have a record in 2015? I bet they did. They have way more records than you realize. Yeah. They put out Too Shabby in 2014, and for some reason... fucking Rate Your Music, man. Power pop alternative rock. It's, yeah. Oh my god, I hate this website. Because Too Shabby was one of my favorite records from 2014. I think 2014 was one of the years I couldn't find because we were posting.
There's a melodic line over a crunchy guitar. It's, yeah, power pop.
Mm-hmm. God. Anyway. I was listening... Ugh, God. I was listening to Lo and Behold a lot in 2015.
Yeah, I just saw that on the charts.
You know, a Starflyer 59 side project with the lead singer of Demon Hunter. But it's good. It sounds like, what? New Order?
Yeah.
It's the best Ryan Clark has sounded in 15 years.
There's a Wailing Storms record.
Yeah, that record is really good. They're a band I very much enjoy. This weird Danzig meets... What is it?
It's like... It's like gothy swamp rock.
Yeah. Yeah. That's true. I was listening to Coheed and Cambria's The Color Before the Sun a lot. That was the only Coheed record that's not part of a concept. And I remembered everybody was like, it's not as good as the concept ones. And I was like, hey, good. I don't have to be embarrassed to say I like this band. Because they just wrote some songs.
The Pleasure Leftists. Put out,
yeah,
The Woods of Heaven that year. That's a great record as well.
It is. And I just discovered they had released a record this year that I completely missed until like 2 or 3 weeks ago, which might be their best record yet. And I don't know if I'll get a chance to talk about it in our best of this year, but because I didn't spend enough time with it. But they are, man, they're a good band. Yeah, I don't see much else in 2015 that I was really digging. Blacklisted put out When People Grow, People Go. That was like their return to form. Like them doing hardcore again, specifically hardcore again, and not so much like the Jesus Lizard-y like noise rock thing. Great record. Man, Blacklisted are one of the better hardcore bands of the last decade. And I don't know if people realize it. Maybe they did early on, but I think people have forgotten how good Blacklisted really are.
Well, unless you have any other big names, we can move on.
2016, number one.
What can be said about 3 years ago?
Yeah, doing math.
I had too much difficulty.
Did you count on your fingers?
Nope.
Oh.
That's what took me so long.
If you had, you'd have been there faster. Number one on the Rate Your Music charts for punk is Jeff Rosenstock's Worry. And Skip.
What? Me Worry? Alfred E. Newman Stock.
Is this the beginning of when Jeff Rosenstock is always in the top five?
Seems like it, yeah, probably. This, and he puts out like a record every year, so not really.
I wish he'd stop.
It was actually like 2 years between Worry and Post.
And a year has gone since Post, so whatever. Number two, Touche Amore. Hey, did you happen to see the Brooklyn Vegan 100 Punk and Emo Albums of the Year?
I saw people posting about it. I don't read Brooklyn Vegan.
It's trash. They have... What was the one that annoyed me the most? They do the thing where they repeat artists. It's like, well, you have a list of 100, and more than 100 records have come out in 10 years. You should not have...
Yeah, you can't pick the one exemplary song a band.
They picked all four Touche Amore albums that were released this decade. Well, maybe not the new one. But they put Parting the Sea, Is Survived By, and Stage 4 on there. What was the other one that really bothered me? It drove me crazy. This is the weirdest list. They said number one is White Reaper.
Didn't that come out this year?
It was... Let me get to it. Oh my god. No, the one from 2014, Deep Fantasy. Yeah. Oh, White Lung, excuse me. God, there's too many white bands.
Can say that again.
In many ways. They have all of the Joyce Manor records on here, too, from this decade. It's like,
okay.
It's the most repetitive...
Essential.
...list I have ever seen. Converge is on here three times, and like they're the only ones I actually think should... maybe be that. Wonder Years are on here three times. Hotelier are on here three times. Pup are on here twice. Yeah. It's just like you...
Yeah.
You... They put the Comadre self-title on here, weirdly. That's the coolest thing. Me Without You's Untitled?
Ew. Yeah.
Yeah.
See, that's why I think that Brooklyn Vegan is a poser website. So...
Yeah, they put that American Nightmare record on there from last year that everybody didn't like, so...
Yeah.
Descendants Hyper Caffeum Spazinate. That record was bad.
Yeah.
I don't know. It
We only listen to the punk records that get pitched to us.
It was very clearly someone who is very young wrote that list, because their frame of reference was literally from the last 5 years for the entire decade. Anyway, weird sidebar. 2016.
Yeah. Just a little... pathological jealousy here.
Is that what that is? Why isn't my list on the Brooklyn Vegans?
Well, you don't live in Brooklyn and you're not a vegan.
As Patty said, the Brooklyn Vegans hate you.
Yeah. Anyway, 2016, back to the list.
Yeah, I don't want to talk about any of these records.
No, there's so much unessential crap. Inessential, excuse me.
And unessential. Okay, there's a Nails record. It's probably the least essential Nails record. You will never be one of us. It's fine. It was just like, oh, it's the third one of these. And okay.
Partially, I think that this list maybe looks the way it does because 2016 is kind of too recent for very many people to be reevaluating.
Yeah.
A lot of the records from that year. If you get to the second page... Shapeshift with Me by Against Me.
You did skip Pups, The Dream Is Over, number 8.
Just looking bleak and I said,
okay.
So I just kind of want to. I'll hit the. Right. I'll hit the things that I don't.
You don't want to talk
of
about
an investment.
In, all right, we'll pretend in, I didn't I think say are any of important. That.
That Savage's record's pretty good.
People talked about that Microwave record a lot when it came out. Much love. Was that first Gouge Away? I think the second Gouge Away was a bigger deal. That first Gouge Away is on here.
And I noticed some things like there's a Gift from God record on page 2 that I think is rated higher because of how popular that band has gotten since then.
Which record is it? Oh, that record was a pretty big deal when it came out, though.
Yeah,
the new one is on like Prosthetic Records, so you know.
Yeah. I don't remember anyone talking about Prince Daddy in 2016. I think that one is a somewhat retroactive.
Right. I don't remember anybody talking about them until last year.
So, yeah, further back, I'm not seeing.
My memory of 2016.
Pray by Planes Mistaken for Stars. No one liked it, but it was a big deal when it came out. Surprising amount of straight up metalcore.
Yeah.
Like a Norma Jean record and that Silent Planet. Isn't that Under Earth Members or something?
Silent Planet? No, but it's Christian metalcore.
Yeah. It's somebody.
I don't know if it, yeah. I don't know if it had anybody in that band, but You Blew It. Although that's not even one. I think everybody was over them by that point. You Blew It.
I feel like they were.
I don't even recognize that album cover.
What
is this? Ugh. I think was 2016 up.
Seeing a lot of names that have gotten themselves canceled, so not going to talk about those. But
yeah. I saw one just there. There was a Mike.
Did you mention that Super Unison record earlier? A second ago.
Who?
Super Unison.
No, I didn't mention it. No.
I'm surprised that's not higher. I think it should be higher.
It was a bigger deal then. Maybe that's part of it. Because I don't know that people were talking about Super Unison like they used to. I feel like Gouge Away kind of stole their thunder. Because the general population can only care about one
right.
hardcore band fronted by a woman at a time.
Yeah, they move on quickly.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think that this... As bleak as this list is, I think that kind of answers a question that I was maybe going to pose about this year. 2016 was bad. Yeah.
I
thought it was just me, because I look at what I listened to, and it was a lot of, like, it was almost nothing but bands I've always listened to.
Yeah, the same ones you were listening to.
So...
What?
There was very little else that cut through. Tinder Defender, that's one that I would say was good.
It was good.
Right.
But you knew all those musicians in that band already. The Iron Sheik and Latterman and Reviver. And so you were very familiar with all of those people already.
It was nothing new. It sounded very much like what you expected it to sound like.
This is a weird list. The highest ranking album on there, and probably the best. Wow. Retroactively, I'm starting to wonder if this really was like one of the best records of the year. Is Pups, The Dream Is Over?
Yeah, I mean it. I listened to it a lot. I mean it's in terms of my most listened records, it's probably number 3 from that year.
Yeah, I'm looking at my list now, like everything I've written down. And as far as, like, coming with me and, like, sticking with me since 2016, it may be the one that stands out the most.
I want to throw this out there real quick, because I've just been scrolling further and further back. At number 336, we have the Skiba 182 record, California. So that was that year. A little further down, you've got Crime Traveler by Graf Orlok, which is...
The weakest Graf record?
The weakest Graf record, yeah.
Because they made their own sound clips for this one.
Man, Showbread is show dead.
Ugh.
I remember listening to it.
Yeah.
So,
that
there's that Arms Aloft record. Such a so-so year.
We listen, so Beachlang put out A Loud Bash of Teenage Feelings, the last record of new material they've released.
Yeah.
It's
they could have waited.
They should have waited. It was not different enough from the previous record, and they put it out too soon after the previous record. That no one cared when this one came out.
It was so much the same so soon that it really drew too much attention to their limitations.
Maybe
looking at the titles, the only two songs that stand out to me are Punks in a Disco Bar, like from what I can remember the song sounding like, and War Paint, the last song, which was the weird one.
It has like a strange...
That's like the breathy, like not really even a song.
Yeah,
like it wasn't like the full band. It was I guess a hint at Quiet Slang.
Yeah, the songs that I remember off that record is Atom Bomb, which may be the worst song on the record.
Oh yeah. I do remember that one too.
That song is bad. It's like
that was the first hint at their potential for butt rock. Would you call it butt rock?
it's definitely radio rock.
It sounds like ass.
It really does. It even sound quality wise sounds different from the rest of the record. Like it sounds like this is a lead single, and it was the lead single for the record, but it seems like it was meant to be a radio single, a radio friendly unit shifter.
Yeah, and it's funny, we're shitting all over this record. I own this record.
I do too. And we made it in our like best of the year.
Yeah. But I'm looking at someone's review here on Rate Your Music, and he points out Hot Tramps and Punks in a Disco Bar are really the only really good songs on the record. Which I do remember Hot Tramps being good, but I also think Hot Tramps is the song that sounds like a direct rewrite of one of the songs from the first EP. Like it's the same chords, like it's the same chord progression, and it's the same little riff. Like I don't remember what song it was that they plagiarized from themselves, but maybe I should go listen to that one again and see if there's something better.
Yeah. This review,
it left a good enough impression on us when we listened to it.
Yeah. This review also says, how the fuck do you get so cornered you have to self-plagiarize after recording a mere 8 songs in 2 years?
Yeah. Enough said.
Yeah. That Pears put out Green Star. I remember that record was talked about a lot. That was also the year I discovered I kind of like them. So that's cool. But I feel like Pears have lost some of their momentum. Have they even followed up that record with anything? Oh, they did that split with Direct Hit.
Yeah.
Which everybody was like, yeah, the Pear side's great.
You know, well, they had a record. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
That's yeah, they it. Haven't done anything else.
Split. Yeah.
So they need to hurry up and get on that. But another Australian band is Violent Soho, who also put out a record in 2016 that was very highly praised. And they also did not capitalize on their success. And they like went on hiatus like pretty quickly after that record. Waco was the name of that record. So I don't know what it is about Australian punk bands that create buzz, but they decide to go on hiatus immediately.
You know what I was just reminded of? The Exquisites put out an album in 2016.
Very good record.
I should listen to that. Because I know I listened to it then, but The Exquisites are a band that every time I hear them, I'm like, why am I not listening to The Exquisites
all the time? Yeah, that record Home is so good. It's like a blending of like soul and punk rock. It's a great record. And again, they haven't really followed it up either. But they're also the type of band that's not going to. Yeah, I mean, like, you know what I mean? Right. Like, they may put out another record for sure, but like, I think you're going to see 2 Exquisites records and that's it.
Yeah. Yeah.
They weren't that big of a hit.
See, Difficult Loves by Ghost Limb. That's a good standout.
Yeah, that was a really good record. Also, Dark Blues, Start the World.
Yeah, and I love Dark Blue, but for some reason that record didn't click for me. I don't know why.
I don't normally do this, but Dark Blue is a band that when I listen to one of their records, I then turn around and listen to the rest of their records, for the most part. And I typically don't do that. I'm normally I listen to this album by this artist, and then I listen to something new from a different, or something different from another artist. Like, I'm not a guy who sits and listens to the entire discography of a band in like a day, except Dark Blue. For some reason, I like, as soon as one finishes, I want to listen to the other one. I don't know what that is about them. I guess that shows you how much I like that band, but I enjoyed that record quite a bit. I'm surprised you didn't like it as much.
Well, I don't know. I guess I don't know why it didn't. I listened to it. I know I did. And I don't know if it was just the timing of when it came out.
It was early in the year. No, it's November.
No, it was late. And that's probably it. Because it came out in November. And then just in between, I don't know, just holidays. And I didn't make the time to listen to it as much. And then I just didn't come back to it.
Yeah.
But again, I knew Dark Blue already.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you did.
See, like, it's very much the same things. My looking at my personal listening, Slow by Starflyer 59.
Yeah.
Was easily my most listened to record. I hardly listened to anything else.
I listened to AJJ's The Bible 2 a lot purely to make myself listen to it. Like, to be like, I'm gonna like it because Christmas Island was such a disappointment for me that I was like, I like this band. I don't like The Bible 2 that much either, unfortunately.
No. That one didn't do it for me. I think I listened to it once and I was like, oh, okay. Yeah, it's more of that.
Yeah. I'm really hoping the next record is better. So far, the only thing they've released... Well, no, the very first song they released was pretty good. And they said it's very heavily influenced by Neil Young's On the Beach. So I'm hoping it's going to be a good record.
Yeah. I don't know if you want to... I don't know if you want to make that comparison to for yourself, though. I feel like that sets the bar really, really high.
Well, they've
That's
definitely...
That's one of my favorite records of all time, so...
They've definitely committed to it, because the album cover by Nate Powell features the car buried in the sand, so...
Yeah.
They're going for it.
Yeah. I listened to All a Man Should Do by Lucero a lot.
Which one's that one?
It's that one.
Is that the name of that record?
Yeah.
The one with Looking for Warren Zevon's Los Angeles?
Yeah.
Damn. I did listen to that record a lot.
It's a good record.
It's good.
It's better than Women in Work.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
And it's their most different sounding record. It's probably the most unique sounding record in their entire discography.
It is. Well, 1372 was, at the time, their most unique sounding record.
But then they did Women in Work.
Yeah, they exactly copied that that record. They Xeroxed that record.
Yeah.
Toy Guitar put out Move Like a Ghost, their second, wait, that wasn't actually even an album, was it, though?
That was an EP.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was good. It was really good.
Yeah.
I did listen to that quite a bit. I listened to, you know what I did listen to a lot? Better Heavens by the Super Weeks.
Yeah. Very good record.
Way better than Bad Year.
Yeah, I listened to that one quite a bit as well. That one's a bittersweet record.
Yeah.
Because of, Corey, their bass player, is passing away immediately before the record came out, but he recorded the album too.
Yeah.
So, you know, his self-portrait is the album cover. And that one was a hard one to listen to just because it was just immediately sad. Like, the second it came out, it was already a sad record, even though the music doesn't necessarily reflect it. But I did listen to that one quite a bit. You know,
I think I wrote a review of that record for New Noise.
Oh, is that one you got in? Oh, yeah, on the site.
That's one I did. Yeah. I also did Fires Within Fires by Neurosis.
Weird.
So that one got quite a few listens for me.
Yeah.
It's a good record.
Yeah, it is.
I mean, it's Neurosis, and the songs are 10 minutes long. It's not something you're going to, like, if you're going to listen to it, you're going to commit to it. So, yeah.
I want to say that 2016 was a year where I was like, yeah, I'll listen to this weird side project as my main listening habit this year. So, so like, Medictation, the Leatherface.
Yeah.
And St. Catherine's supergroup, which featured Dickie from Leatherface prior to his passing. And it sounds like a Leatherface record. And in the best way possible. Like, with the exception of different vocals. I listened to that record probably more... That was probably one of the most listened to records I had that year. And then I also listened to Chandeliers, which was... What? A side project? A one-off project? It...
Yeah. Like, it was gonna... It was gonna be... They were like... It was members of previous bands.
Yeah. New
band.
It's a members of band.
Then didn't pan out.
Yeah. Marissa Bergquist from... She's been in a ton of bands, but none of them were, like, ever...
Household names.
Yeah, they weren't super well-known. She's an amazing vocalist, and, you know, she plays keys in Chandeliers. We saw them at Fest.
Yeah.
It's a great record, but, yeah, they're a band that no one knows, made up of members of bands that no one knows, unfortunately. What else did I listen to? There's some good EPs... There's a Year of Glad EP, and Adult Magic put out their first EP.
Right. That Year of Glad, is that the first Year of Glad?
It's called I Don't Know Where I Am Either. Is that the very first one? They did two EPs, and that was it. Another band that no one else listened to. That featured Mimi of Nona and Chris Diem of 1994, and a few other people, too.
No, that's the second EP. Wasn't as good as the first one.
Yeah, that's the thing where I should just put it on on a CD and just listen to them back to back.
The only other record that stands out to me was Painkillers by Brian Fallon, his first true solo record. I said on our was that on the last episode or is that
which one?
Horrible Crows or whatever.
Yeah, called. Yeah, that's on the
that'll be on the last episode,
the part one. Yeah.
Well, I said on our last episode he wasn't quite ready yet. This one he was.
Yeah.
Painkillers is a great record. It took a little time for me to really appreciate it, but that was also true of his next solo record. That one didn't immediately hook me, but the more I went back to it, and I have a feeling that that's gonna be what happens with the with the next solo record, because the first single I heard, I was like, it's fine. But I know I'll listen to it, and then I'll keep listening to it, and it'll really grow on me. I have a strong feeling about that. So, but that's it. I mean, Bob, really, for that's 2016 for me.
Bob Mould put out Patch the Sky.
True. Yeah.
That's it. That's literally it.
And that one, actually, that record is where the Bob Solo records really clicked personally for me.
Yeah. Yeah.
I listened to Patch the Sky... And I had listened to the ones before it, but I listened to Patch the Sky, and then I went back and listened to those, like, a whole bunch. So they, like, all got jumbled together
mm-hmm.
as I kind of reevaluated them. And
we saw him on that tour.
Shit, it was. Man. Yeah. Wow.
That was also, what, a week or 2 weeks after the 2016 election? And Bob went off on this really, like, impassioned outburst of just how disappointed he was. And that was so memorable to me that when I... And also even himself, because when I saw Bob Mould this year, he referenced the last time he was in North Carolina and how mad he was. And he was like, I wish somebody had filmed that, because I haven't done that since then. So we saw something quite unique. We caught him at a very odd night.
Something set him off.
Yeah. Well, the election.
Well, and it's specifically that night.
Yeah. It was weird.
He just something snapped. But
yeah.
That's really all I've got for 2016.
Yeah. You bought me that Gunshy record, the Porterhouse for Christmas. That's a great record. I love that record quite a lot. The Gunshy are incredibly underrated. Like... alt country sort of punk, but that record is great. That record is really good.
I would call it alt country.
Yeah.
I
mean, it is
more so than what a lot of people call alt country.
Mm-hmm.
I've noticed a lot of Americana gets labeled as alt country, and it's like, are they punks playing country? Because that's kind of what alt country is.
Well, Uncle Tupelo is kind of...
That record doesn't even have a genre on Rate Your Music.
I'm surprised it's not, like, tagged folk punk.
Everything else is.
Just because all his other records are called folk punk?
Well, no, not they don't all have a genre labeled on them, so.
Yeah. He's so closely associated with AJJ, primarily because he did one split with them, but also I think Sean recorded one of, maybe Matt's solo record, I think even had some, like, appearances by AJJ members, so they get kind of tied together with them, but...
Yeah, they did Return of the Grievous Angels. Just recently, Graham Parsons and Emmylou Harris. Sean sang Emmylou's part.
Yeah. I think the Gunshy deserves more attention. If you're interested in more, like, folk... Imagine if, like, Frankie Stubbs from Leatherface, like, played in a country band, or an alt-country band, then you kind of get an idea of what the Gunshy sound like. But let's move into 2017. Woo, 2017.
It's worse.
Yeah. It is. Okay, looking at the Rate Your Music chart for 2017.
It's a recency bias, I'm sure.
Number one is Converge, The Dusk in Us. Episodes in the past, anytime Converge puts out a record, they're in the top five, deservedly so, I suppose. This record, The Dusk in Us, where does it rank for you as far as like 2010's Converge records, though?
Let's see.
There's only two. Never mind. So,
yeah, because Axe to Fall was 2009. I do like it more than Axe to Fall.
Yes, it is better than Axe to Fall, but not as good as No Heroes and not as good as All We Love We Leave Behind. So. Middle of their discography? Lower half? I guess probably technically lower half, depending on how much you enjoy Halo and Haystack and the early stuff. The pre-Jane Doe stuff.
I listened to this record a lot. I don't know if it's necessarily because I loved it so much, though I did really enjoy it, as much as I didn't give a shit about anything that year. I mean, I really did not care. I didn't pay attention to anything new. I almost exclusively listened to old stuff.
What is this top 10?
I mean, looking at the chart...
Why the fuck is Brand New still on the...
Right.
That was the year they got canceled.
Well, it was the year that record came out, too.
And that was the year that people on fucking Punk News put it in their top 10 or whatever. Yeah. After he'd already been, like, outed as a fucking monster.
Yeah.
That is what 2017 was, though. 2017 was chock full of shitty men being exposed for their behavior.
Yeah. And people making a lot of excuses for it.
Yeah, unfortunately. Oh, look, there's two back-to-back. 23 and 24. I'm not saying their names. But both of those bands.
Did we confirm?
Yes, I was confused about the wrong band. Number 24 is the shitty one, but they have not been formally canceled, so we'll...
Yeah.
I'm not giving names to them, though. Look at this list.
And you know what? Like, what stands out to me as, like, oh, I'd listen to that now.
What?
I mean, Well, that Drab Majesty record is actually really good.
Yeah, that's a great record.
But I didn't know that then.
It took me a minute.
But like, I would honestly, I would probably go listen to that Menzingers record if I had to pick records from this year to go listen to.
I'd listen to that Incendiary record. Actually, I did listen to that Incendiary record quite a bit that year. Yeah, that Menzingers. They've never clicked for me, but
I did listen to that Mac Tower Scan record.
It's pretty good. I feel like it was too late though for them. Like everyone else started playing that style of music at that exact same time, so everyone forgot about them because they'd been doing it.
I completely forgot that Propagandhi put out Victory Lap that year.
Who cares?
That seems older than that.
Propagandhi released the same album like 5 times in a row now. Like, I'm not a fan of metal Propagandhi.
Here's one that should be on the first page. I don't know why this isn't on my list. You Can't Stay Here by Iron Sheik.
Yeah, I was gonna say, Iron Sheik are the example of the band who's basically made the same record multiple times, but they've spent enough time between records that it's where Beach Slang messed up by putting out the same record too quickly. Iron Sheik is smart enough to space them out by like at least 2 to 3 years.
But you know, I did see people complaining a lot about this one.
They did. A bunch of whiny babies were like, "It sounds exactly the same as the last two." It's like, yeah, it's a great sound.
it's a good sound. Also, every song's gonna be in the same key when that's how your vocalist sings.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just like not even an octave.
Right.
He's got one of the most limited ranges. And it sounds great.
Yeah.
It's perfect for that band. It's like a hardcore vocalist, but melodic.
Which I want to say he was in some bands that were like borderline hardcore bands early on. Like Small Arms Dealer, I think, was his old band. And it's a little faster and a little shoutier, but it is his voice. Jason Lubrano's voice. Yeah, I mean, that record came out 2017. The Constant one came out 2013. That's what? Is that 5 years? 4 years? 4 years? God, I had to do math on my fingers. I'm not bright. Yeah, that was probably my... Well, let's look. I found my list from that year. This I wanted list. To see where it fell on there.
This chart is so bad.
Yeah, it was my number one.
Yeah. It probably... Yeah.
Looking,
I don't know why it's not on my list, but I know I listened to it. Looking at these charts, I want to rattle off a couple of records by bands that they were either notable for being like reunion records or mm-hmm. they're records that you would have asked yourself, they're still making records? Godless Prophets by Darkest Hour.
That was a decent record. It was probably the best Darkest Hour record since, what was that one, the last good one, Deliver Us?
Yeah.
And even Deliver Us was only okay.
But there's a Silverstein record.
Yeah. That band has never gone away.
Nope. There's the very underwhelming Interiors by Quicksand.
Woo. Can we all admit that
Quicksand wasn't good?
Quicksand's not actually a good band. They have, what, half of a good album? Slip?
Here, yeah.
Slip?
Right.
Slip is good, but I get bored halfway through it every time I listen to it and switch to something else.
Yeah. Preferably, like, Seaweed or something.
Yeah. More fun version of what they were doing. I mean, it's proto-new metal.
It is. It totally is. There's a Tiger's Jaw record that I don't think I even recognize the album cover.
Is that the one with, like, it's a photo and it's,
It's like a still life.
Yeah, Spin. I think I listened to it once just to see what they were doing, and I was like, oh yeah, the same thing.
There's the At the Drive-In
I wish bands would stop doing that kind of thing.
Which that's the 17-year follow up to Relationship of Command. I don't know anyone who actually listened to that record, so I just remember it coming out and thinking, who cares? Like, at this point, really, who cares?
I don't remember I don't know anyone who actually even listened to it. I'm sure we know people who listen to it. I'm sure guests of the show have listened to it, but I didn't.
There's a World is a Beautiful Place record that I didn't even know came out.
I didn't even recognize that album cover.
I don't recognize the name, the album cover, anything.
There are a band that has a consistent look across their discography. It's a photo of outside. That's every album cover.
Here's a little bit of proof about how dismal this year is. Within the top 100, Dad Thighs record is number like 93.
It's not a bad record.
Like a Canadian DIY emo band.
Yeah. It wasn't bad. I remember listening to it. I thought it was a solid record. But it was like, yeah, you're right. Them?
I mean, there's some stuff that... Floating Now, Hard Girls. That's a good one.
Yes, that's a good record. It's the last Hard Girls record to come out. They're the type of band, though, that could, you know, all of a sudden put out something new. Though I do think Mike is working on a solo record right now, so I'm excited to hear what that's going to be. Hard Girls are a band with a... Not a super... They have three albums and a really long EP.
Yeah, it is.
It's like a six-track EP, and it's as long as the first record, I think. But they're a band that's just been consistent with all of their records. They're all good records. They're all quality. They sound good. They're just good dudes. That's always been my takeaway from Hard Girls. Katie Ellen put out her. That's not even her name. Anika from Chumped put out that Katie Ellen record, Cowgirl Blues.
It is confusing.
Yeah. Yes. The name of the band is Katie Ellen. There is no one in that band named Katie Ellen. It's Anika Pyle from Chumped and Dan Frehley. I don't know who Dan Frehley is, but he could be another Chumped. He is, the drummer. And then the other two members of Chumped started their own band that was very forgettable. I can't even remember their name. That Katie Ellen record is good, and it kind of shows the maybe why Chump didn't quite last, because it's a much more indie album than like a poppy punk album that Chumped was. Oh man, 2017 was a bad year too.
Yeah, I mean, I'm struggling to find records that even now I would want to go back to. Survival Pop by Warriors.
Good record that I didn't discover until this year. So, that's right.
I really liked Imaginary Life when it came out, and then for some reason I didn't listen to Survival Pop that year. I don't know. I was completely out of touch. I also moved across the country, so yeah. I was just very preoccupied and
yeah,
out of sorts, I guess.
I'm looking at my list from that year. Like I made a list of like the 100 records I liked from that year. What was I doing? My number two is Bear Trade, Silent Unspeakable.
Not waving, but drowning, and I've not got me armbands. But if I'm floating, I'm not standing, and who needs the strength in these legs? Oof. It's not the motion in the ocean.
After this record came out, and I did listen to it a lot, but I had but I also have an album from a band called Green Sleep.
I remember you mentioning that band.
Yeah, they were like a 90s indie, like sort of Archer's Love Superchunk style band from Long Island. They were kind of like Long Island legends. And so like they reunited and Dead Broke put out that record, Cheap Headphones. I loved the hell out of that record that year, but I have yet to go back to it in the 2 years since, so.
Here's one. Open City. That came out.
Oh, yeah. Man, that band should have done more.
A one-off hardcore record that was really good, but there was no sustained interest in it.
Yeah.
Sick City by Wailing Storms.
Yeah.
That's one you would have liked a lot.
Yeah, it's number 8 on my list from that year.
So, you know what I did listen to that year? I have a very short list. Other than Iron Sheik and Converge, this is what I know I listened to. Shane Torres's album. At least twice.
Yeah.
If not more than that. Katie really liked it a lot, so I listened to it quite a bit. So many references to him all the time. He's brilliant. Adios by Corey Brannan.
Adios, amigos.
It's a Corey Brannan record. The songs are really good. It's really weirdly overproduced. But I think that record, I kind of just accepted that's what his records sound like. Because I remember listening to his previous records and being like, really wish that it was just him and acoustic guitar. Because that's how he plays live. And that was how I was introduced to him. But this one, I get it. He wants to make studio records, and he can do most of it himself. But that was a pretty good record. It's got some really strong songs. There's some guest spots on it. Laura Jean Grace, I want to say, does some backup vocals on one of the songs somewhere. And there's Dave House is on there as well a couple times.
Talking about how close friends he is with everybody.
Yeah, he just like butts into the middle of the song. He's like, I was talking to my good buddy, Brian Fallon. And he was like, hey, my friend Corey Brannan's making a new record. He's like, oh, I should give him a call. This is weird. Did Rodney Crowell play drums on this record?
Who's that?
Rodney Crowell is like a classic Nashville songwriter, like 70s songwriter. 70s and 80s mostly. He was in Emmylou Harris's band. He's married to Roseanne Cash, or he was. That's crazy. I didn't know that. But other than that, Low Tom.
Yeah, Low Tom.
That's it. That's the end of my list.
How many times have we listened to Low Tom on the way to Phoenix?
Once.
That it? No, we listened to it at least 2 or 3 times.
I really think I only played it once.
No, we played it more than once.
We listened to at least one Starflyer record each day.
Yeah, we did. We listened to, like, every Dark Blue album, too.
We listened to, I think we were listening to Where the Strings Come In by Superchunk. And you were like, I think this angular music is making you angry. I was probably screaming in traffic.
Yeah. You driving down the mountain on the way into Arizona, into Phoenix in the, moving truck was very, very stressful. Because you were going so fast. Downhill.
We had to get there on time because the office manager was, like, calling me. I was like, where are you?
I know, and you were talking on the phone, driving a moving truck very fast, down a mountain, on a windy road. All downhill.
No, there was a lot of uphill. It was downhill and then it was uphill.
Yeah, it was like got lower down.
Really drastic. Like, like, oh shit, now I gotta floor it and climb back up this hill.
I was terrified. And I couldn't even be like, that's fine, he knows this car. It wasn't your car, it was a moving truck. I wouldn't have worried in anyone else's normal vehicle, but... yeah.
You hit the limiter and you just feel it. Like,
So for me, a lot of 2017 was just spent listening to Mike Park bands. So Oki Kubo Station put out their self-titled. Kitty Cat Fan Club put out, what was the name of that EP? Workspace Grind. And I want to say there was another Mike Park associated record, but I could be wrong. Yeah. I'm looking at my list from that year and like my organization and everything on it. A lot, the bottom half, I would not include on a list today. Even like if I went through the 2017 charts and made a new list, half of this stuff wouldn't be here.
What would you cut?
Well, I had the Angus LP1 as my number 10 album overall. Do you remember who Angus is?
No one
knows who Angus is. Angus was the post Young Leaves band.
Oh.
Yeah. I listened to the hell out of that record. It was called LP1. It did not have a vinyl pressing. I listened to that Heat album overnight. It was like a Jesus and Mary Chain record style record. And
I'm going to pretend that I'm watching Heat.
Radio Hospital put out Play the Song You Like. A little underwhelming record, but probably the last best Radiator Hospital album, which there hasn't been much more. My list is weird.
I didn't miss anything.
All Vase,
essentially.
Antisocialites. That one probably would be higher, to be honest. Chastity Belt put out a record I liked a lot. Yeah. I listened to that Ben Gibbard covering Bandwagon-esque a bunch of times, and all I would do is, oh, that's what 2017 was. That was the year where I just listened to Teenage Fan Club nonstop.
I actually have a note here that on 2016 is when I discovered Teenage Fan Club. Because they put out Here that year, didn't they? Right? That was 2016.
I think so. Yeah.
We didn't talk about that at all.
Not really a punk record, though.
But yeah, I listened to that a ton in 2017.
Yeah. Yeah, 2017, 2018, that was my Teenage Fan Club, like, deep dive. Like, the 2017 was the, like, Bandwagon-esque and Grand Prix and 13 listening. And then 2018 was, like, the back half of their catalog listening. So, yeah. Weird year. Unless there's anything else you want to talk about with 2017, we can move into 2018.
No. I think we're good. Let's move on.
Yeah. So, 2018, let's pull that up on the chart, I think is also a bad year. I think...
So, we're saying this, and if you're listening and you're like, these guys are wrong, tell us.
Yes.
Send us an email. What did you like from 2017? What did you like from 2018?
Not only send us an email, punklottopod@gmail.com, but give us a call. I set up a voicemail. So, if you feel like leaving a voicemail telling us how wrong we are about the last 5 years of the decade, you should give us a call. The phone number is 202-688-PUNK.
Nice.
The 202 is actually a Washington, D.C. area code, so I was like, that's fitting. That's good. Discord Records home. Yeah, leave us a voicemail. If it's good, maybe I'll play it on the show. Can't wait to get hate mail. All right, 2018. Okay, I think 2018 is better than 2017. Do you have the list yet?
Yes.
Well, I'm sending it anyway. Okay.
Well, I got it.
So okay, let's
don't send it to me.
On the rate, I already sent it. Number one on the rate music chart is Parquet Courts Wide Awake. We talked about that briefly. I get why that record was as liked as it was. I don't think it really transferred over to 2019 though. Indie rock is, like, especially, like, music journalism and indie rock is very much on to the next thing.
So I'm looking at 2018. I don't give a shit about the top 40.
Number two is Idols, Joy is an Act of Resistance. That is actually a very, very good record.
I just didn't listen to it.
It was very hyped, and Idols have actually maintained their hype. Great record. Tropical Fuckstorm was kind of... It was a pretty decent record. It's like half of a great record and half of just like too arty for its own good. There's Veins, Aerozone. That record's really hype. I enjoyed it at the time, but they're assholes. So
yeah.
Jeez, Me Without You put out Untitled. Birds in a Row put out a record I forgot they put out. We Already Lost the World. Ice Age. That record was actually higher rated when it came out. It's funny to see it has dropped. It was like probably like one or two. The Armed, everybody talked about that Armed record. I don't know why. Hers Collective was a big deal. Friends, Lovers, and Favorites. That was a really big deal. It kind of put Get Better Records on the map. Portrayal of Guilt, that's a retroactive rating.
Yeah, I don't know. I got nothing off that first page.
Shame put out Songs of Praise. I really enjoyed that record, too. It's very much in the vein of Idols, a UK punk band. That Candy record is pretty interesting. Like, Hardcore actually did pretty well in 2018, it looks like. And also did well in 2019 in its own right. Gouge Away put out Burnt Sugar. That was a very hyped record.
So here's one we talked about it last year on our best of. We could talk about it again, though. Was Hot Snakes, Jericho Sirens.
Yeah.
Great record.
It is a really good record.
Really should be in the top 10.
It should.
And I don't know what is wrong with radio music, because this seems like the kind of record that they would be into.
Yeah.
But let's see if my rating bumped it up. Nope. Didn't change it. That's a great record.
Yeah, 2018.
So there's a cursive record.
Yeah.
Dose Your Dreams by Fucked Up. Everyone wanted to try and convince me that that was a really great, important record. it's just another Fucked Up record.
Yeah. I mean, they have so many.
They all sound like that, too.
Yeah.
Like Andrew W.K.
A punk Andrew W.K.
Yeah. That's what it sounds like to me.
Yeah.
Is this thing cursed by Alkaline Trio?
Yeah.
Honestly, everyone loved it, and it didn't blow me away.
I liked it a lot.
I wish that they had not rewritten Pretty Teeth as the title track for this record.
What?
Like, they legitimately rewrote a Dan song from Party Adjacent. Same chords, same melody, just different words.
Did they admit that, or was that just your...
I don't know if they talked about it anywhere, but it blatantly is. Like, I don't know why they did that. Because Pretty Teeth is a great intro on that Dan record, and then they used it as an intro on this record, just with not as good lyrics. Blackbird, it's about a woman who's a fighter jet. I feel like that's especially stupid, even for Matt Skiba. And nothing else stands out to me. None of these other songs stand out to me.
I don't know, maybe it's because we were all like, oh, he's back in Alkaline Trio. He's not doing the dumb Blink record right now. Though that would come later. Remember, those Blink albums and tours paid for these Alkaline Trio records. So I really enjoyed this song. I remember the title. I thought the title track, Is This Thing Cursed, was definitely one of the standouts. It's the one I remember the most, I guess. It's also the name of the record, so that might be part of why I remember it so well.
I don't know. It just didn't. Everyone was like, Alkaline Trio is back. They got their mojo back. And I'm like, they got their mojo back on My Shame Is True. You should have listened to My Shame Is True. It was a great album.
What if it was more of a confirmation? Was everyone like, it's a fluke? No one wanted to admit that My Shame Is True was as good as it was because they didn't want to get betrayed by them again.
Yeah, that's true.
And so they were like, all right, we can safely say they're back now.
But they're not. I mean, are they?
I mean, they haven't done anything since then, but...
I mean, they're touring next year with Bad Religion.
Yeah.
Trying to decide if it's worth $40 just to see Alkaline Trio play half a set that I'm interested in.
I think you've come to your decision already.
Probably not gonna go.
No, I wouldn't.
I still haven't seen them.
If they were in Charlotte, I wouldn't go.
If I knew the set list was gonna be, like, perfect, I would go.
It's not.
But I know it's gonna be very heavy on Is This Thing Cursed.
Maybe. You can always look at the tour, like, go to setlist.fm or whatever that site's called and just read the set list and think, oh, that's a pretty good set list, and then go see it. What are you... So, there's not... I guess because it's still so recent, there's not a, like, consistent... There's not a consensus on what was really good about that year, about 2018. What records were really good in 2018...
Like, I'm looking through the charts, and stuff that's standing out to me as, like, notable, there's that Super Unison record, Stella.
Mm-hmm. that Fiddlehead record, Springtime and Blind, was like a sleeper hit. So like people into them are way into them, and you still see a lot of their name pops up quite a bit, especially if you like look at like the hardcore scene in like the Northeast. So I think the next Fiddlehead record is gonna be like one of the most hyped records whenever does come out.
There's that Laura Jane and the Devouring Mothers record. Is it drastically different from Against Me? I haven't listened to it.
I don't know. I didn't listen to it either. I don't
really understand the point of it, if it's not.
I don't know. Lead singers doing side projects is always weird to me, unless the band is completely different.
Yeah. It's just that it doesn't matter who else is in Against Me.
I mean, it's been such a rotating lineup for so long.
At this point, it's just her band, so...
I mean, some people have come back from being gone after a while, too, so...
Maybe. The Mesthetics.
Ugh, I wanted to like that so much.
Right.
It's so boring. It's just math.
This should be great.
It's not even fun math rock. It's literally like jazz math rock. It's like, ugh. But
yeah, right. It's Joe Lally and Brendan Candy. I mean, it's not the members of Fugazi that are going to make it really interesting. I think that Joe Lally and Brendan Candy are great musicians.
Right.
But like, I don't listen to Joe Lally solo records.
No.
What else did Brendan Candy do?
He was in a few things, but I don't know if he had...
Happy Go Licky. I mean...
Which was just...
One Last Wish, Rites of Spring.
Yeah.
Yeah. So...
It's also instrumental.
Right.
And that hurts it. Yeah, he was in... I mean, he was in Fugazi, but...
Right. But, Awake But Still in Bed, what people call low self-esteem is really just seeing yourself the way that other people see you.
That was a good record that was very hyped.
I'm really surprised, honestly, that that's not in the top 40.
I am too, because it was well-liked then. It's still well-regarded now. That album is on the Brooklyn Vegan 100 Punk and Emo Records. So
yeah,
somebody likes it. It's a good record. I think they're another band, though, that the next record is going to be, like, the one, too. So it is kind of fun, like, being able to see the band that's about to put out the next big thing.
Yeah, we are at that point. There's a Baptist record. I feel like there's always a Baptist record.
Yeah.
Here's another one. I saw a lot of hype then, and I kind of see some potential. Alien Boy, Sleeping Lessons came out.
Yeah.
That year. I feel like they're on... I wonder if they're not... If they didn't blow up on that record, if they're not going to. I wonder if they're on the tail end. I mean, it was only 2018, so...
Yeah, I mean, it's so hard to say. Thinking about...
I want to say that they were on, like, a hype package tour.
Yeah.
And I don't think... They haven't released anything else. And they probably should have followed that tour up with at least like an EP or something just to kind of keep people's attention. So maybe they've got something coming out early next year and that'll be the right moment for them.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that's a band that could be missing their shot.
You know, looking at a lot of these records, I do think we are going... Looking at... 2017 and 2018, how it wasn't that great of a year, and the standout records that did come out that year, and the breakout acts, knowing that most bands have like a two-year window, I do think 2020 has the potential of being a really great year, as long as these albums deliver, you know, on expectations. But I think that we have a lot of bands who are like up and coming or like have just now hit their stride so that their next release should be a monster. I think 2020 is going to turn out to be a good year. Because 2019, not to tip your hand too much, I do think is a better year than the previous years before it.
Yeah. Well, and we'll talk about that when we do our full recap on 2019. But
yeah.
I heard a lot more records.
Yeah. In a good way.
Like, I was... a lot more plugged in, and looking at these charts, I want to say that it's because better stuff was coming out in 2019.
Yeah, I think
there was more for me to go, oh, I like that, I want to listen to that record.
Yeah.
Whereas in the stuff I heard in 2017, 2018, it was like, I'm not going to invest the time because this one song didn't hook me.
So, anyway. Looking at, like, I have our, we, last year we did our best of, or I guess in January, we did our best of 2018 two-parter. And for the most part, it's still pretty fresh in my head. I put that Ogikubo Station full length. We can pretend like we had that Photo Crime record, Principle of Pain. Fourth Wanderers put out their one record, and we were speculating what happened with the band who disappeared in the middle of their tour, like 2 weeks into their tour. Turns out the lead singer suffered like massive like anxiety and panic attacks and basically agoraphobia, like an extreme mm-hmm. version of it. So that's why that band disappeared, unfortunately. Brian Fallon has one that I can't read because I put the thing over top of it. Do you remember the name of that record?
Sleepwalkers.
Yeah. And there are other good things. Like Lucero put out Among the Ghosts. Superchunk put out What a Time to Be Alive. But the three in here that I listened to a lot that year was Soccer Mommy, Retirement Party, and Remember Sports. Remember Sports just got a deluxe reissue of all of their records because the label that put them out like sold out of everything they had, and so like there was this huge demand to repress their whole catalog. So I think Remember Sports is if they put out a record in 2020, they are going to be one of the biggest things.
They're riding that wave.
Same with Retirement Party.
They better have something. Yes.
Retirement Party had a massive wave with that one. I can't remember the name of that record because it doesn't have the title on the album cover right now. It is Somewhat Literate. They've released, I think, one or two songs from something upcoming that they could potentially be one of the biggest bands in 2020 whenever they put out. And Soccer Mommy has released a couple tracks for her new record. Like I'm saying, 2020 has a lot going for it, and I can't wait to actually see what happens with a lot of these bands.
Let's shit on a couple more records.
All right.
Real quick. Self Defense Family put out Have You Tried Punk Music? Which I responded, Have you tried punk music?
Have you?
Because I don't think that's a punk record.
No, and I didn't even listen. For a band that I listened to for 7 years straight on a regular basis, every single thing they put out, every single EP they put out, I didn't listen to that record once.
There's that band Gogs. I don't know if they're good or not, but I just think of Gog from Peep Show.
I've not heard of this band.
here's some real good like why with like five question marks. Franz Ferdinand put out an album. There's an impending doom record.
That's a world we'll never understand. That current metalcore scene. I don't get it. I don't get it at all. Who is that for?
And I mean, there's like a Bless the Fall record.
Yeah, I just saw that.
There's an Under Oath record.
There was a Direct Hit record that year?
Yeah.
I checked out of that band.
There's a Single Mother's record that year.
People love that band.
But look how far that slipped.
Yeah.
I mean,
but people still love them. I saw people this week talking about Single Mothers.
There's a Pennywise record?
Yeah. Sure. There's a Terror record?
Right. It's kind of like Baptist. There's always a Terror record. Is this the year, or was that 2017, where there's the Trapped Under Ice record?
I don't know. I'm not Superman. That's my favorite thing about that band. Him getting jumped on by people singing along, and he freaks out. And is like, get off me! I'm not Superman! there's a War on Women record, Capture the Flag. That's way lower than I thought it would be.
Yeah, that one should be... That one should be higher.
Yeah.
Just not because I particularly love it, but just because of how much people talk about that band.
Yeah, and how fun they are live. I think that's what people like about War on Women the most. It's like skate punk. Like, I'm just... almost skate punk. It's kind of thrashy. It's not my favorite kind of punk, but it's a solid record for what it is, and they are incredibly fun to watch live. American Nightmare put out a bad record that nobody liked, that I already mentioned.
There was a Death Petals record?
Who?
Like a post-hardcore band I remember listening to in like 2015 or something. Weird.
Hawthorne.
Catch on.
Hawthorne Heights put out a record. Chelsea Grin. I forgot about that Swing and Utters record.
Yeah. It's only a Swing and Utters record.
I mean, they have like three good records and they all came out in the 90s.
I mean, there is a never-ending supply of metalcore bands from the mid-2000s that are still making records.
I don't know how.
So we don't even honestly have to name every single one of them because they're not good.
Parkway there's Drive.
There's a State Champs record.
Yeah.
I'm
seeing a lot of stuff that was talked about that's not higher. Like, there's the Eco Strike record. That record's good. And was well-liked. That Vamachara record was well-liked. Like, it's weird that what hardcore records are not still in higher up, even though they were talked about then.
You know, it's weird. No one talked about that Red Hair record.
No, because it's...
I don't think I even listened to it.
It's a Red Hair record. I mean, sure Red Hair good. Are good, and it's because it's full of musicians from Discord that, and the DC scene that people don't love as much. I mean, there's Dag Nasty people, I guess, but... No, Sean Brown is the Dag Nasty person, though, so...
Well, he was in Swizz.
Yeah, people like Swizz better than they like his Dag Nasty stuff, so, because there's not much Dag Nasty stuff, but... Yeah, I mean, that's just Jason Farrell's lane, you know.
No one cares.
No one cares about Blue Tip, but really.
It's really, really good.
But it's good. It's just no one cares.
Oof. 41 by Reggie and the Full Effect. Ooh.
Is that song about him, that album about that him turning 41?
No one needed any more Reggie records.
No. No one, no. I really, no one needs any Reggie records. They had its place, I guess, but it was almost like mocking. There was a good Charlotte record.
Yeah, right.
Whoa. Okay,
here's some records you should listen to. Secret Club by Pogo.
That's a great record that needs to be much higher.
There's Nothing Blues by Typesetter.
Great record. Maybe they're one of their best records. Yeah, these are the type of records, though, that they just didn't have quite the attention, so that's why they're not any higher than they are. That's why it's weird. Like, if you look at the middle of these charts, you'll find some real good stuff, but...
Oh, sure. I mean, you could go to the last page and find stuff that you heard.
I wonder if I could, because I paid $4 to renew my Rate Your Music, so I get 35 pages of results now. Do I have anybody I know? I really hope I do. No, I don't. That's disappointing.
Was it worth the $4?
Yes, it is, actually. There's stuff in those pages, those like 25, between 25 and 35 that I missed. But, okay, let's go to actual page 25, the last page that you can look at.
Okay.
You plebe.
I'm not recognizing anything yet.
That Custody record. I liked that Custody record. They were a Finnish punk band. Very Iron Sheik style. They played Fest last year. That record's great. See?
So there's your homework.
Yep. Go listen to Custody. That's a good record. Yeah, it's the only other one I recognize on that last page, but...
Yeah.
What do
I
we...
don't know.
I guess... Ta-da! This decade started strong. Kind of whimpered out at the end.
Well...
And 2019 picked up, but...
2019 picked up. And join us next week as we talk about 2019 in depth. For part one, we are doing two parts, right?
Yes, we are.
Of our best albums from 2019. I'm excited to talk about those records.
We've got some surprises for you. I won't say them now, but...
Well, then they wouldn't be surprises.
Yep, yeah, well, right. I will say our opinion will not be the only opinion of 2019.
Yeah.
very important. We probably should have had some opinions on these years too.
Yeah, we really, really should have.
Oh,
we're
well.
Sorry.
Sorry about that.
Hey, if you listened to 4 hours of us bumbling through the last 10 years of music,
remember that?
That was your fault. Hey, there's a Canadian Rifle record in 2018.
Yep, it's not a bad record.
Should probably listen to that one. I'm going to stop scrolling because my eyes are glazing over.
Yeah, and this is the third time I've recorded today, and we have more recording to do tomorrow. So, a little behind the curtain. Well, thank you. If you made it through the show, thank you. We know two, possibly three people who did.
Tell us the secret word, which I'm just going to choose to say is the casket lottery, because there was a 3LP box set in 2018.
How did you find that?
That's number 759.
Why is that listed?
Because people really suck at adding records to Rate Your Music. Send us an email with the casket lottery as the subject line, and we will include you as a guest on the show. As a consolation for listening to us ramble through the tweenies.
Email us, punklottopod@gmail.com, your favorite records of the decade. Legit. Do it. I dare
you.
We'll
read them.
Coward. Do it.
Leave us a voicemail.
It is 202-688-PUNK. That is 202-688-7865. Punk is easier to remember. I liked all the repeating numbers, so that's why I picked that one.
It's just yellow letters, yellow numbers on a blue screen. Order now.
Yeah. Just send shipping and handling.
Make sure to have parents' permission before calling.
Yeah. Call us. Tell us your favorite records. Call us. Tell us we're a bunch of wieners. I don't care. Call us.
Tell us dollar signs and Jeff Rosenstock rule. And
we're wrong. Because I believe that I'm wrong. Who am I? Who are we to say that our opinion is more important or more accurate than anyone else's? I guess me, because, you know, I paid my hosting fees to post this on a website and then transmit it on the internet.
That's just narcissism, though. Like, that's not...
The true mission of this show from the beginning was to just be able to talk about music.
Yeah, yeah.
For fun. For no reason. For fun. That's the only reason. It's a lot of work for a thing that's supposed to be fun. But just reflect on the decade of Punk Lotto Pod that was. We started in the fall of 2018. We went all the way through 2019. Big decade for us.
Yeah. We can end the show next year and be able to tell people that we did a podcast for 2 decades.
Across 2 decades. Yeah, we're just rambling now. This is very long, and it shouldn't be any longer than it needs to be. So follow us on all the social medias, Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook at PunkLottoPod. Our website is punklottopod.simplecast.fm. We are on Spotify, Stitcher, iTunes, probably other things. We're supposedly on Google Play. Oh, we are, because Paul listens to us on Google Play. Thanks, Paul.
Thanks, Paul. Let us know if you're still having issues with episodes not showing up.
Yeah. He probably wishes more didn't.
Mm-hmm. I gotta listen to this.
No. Why is it so long?
He started something, and now he can't stop. We see you, Paul. We know you're just like us. Completists. You don't enjoy it anymore.
This is how we really maintain listenership, is by forcing them to be part of the show. So they have to keep listening. Yeah, thanks a lot. Join us next week for another out of nowhere, off topic, off format. I don't know. I just need to stop this now.
Rambling mess.
Yeah, I gotta clean all this up.
Or don't. Who cares?
Who gives a shit?